Japji, the heartbeat of Nanak. That which is heartbeat of someone, how can you connect to that? Unless you know your energy have moved to the heart center, you will not be able to connect. Unless you have attained to that level of consciousness that Nanak represents, you will not be able to understand the message. And this applies not only to the message of Nanak, but all those who have attained. You can give a philosophic interpretation, and philosophic interpretations will be many. Each is trying to look at the message from his own point of view, his own understanding, his own level of growth. But that is not the meaning of Nanak. Each word is soaked with the understanding of Nanak. And these are not the ordinary words. You can get literal or philosophical meaning. You can give your interpretations. However, the mystical meaning that Nanak gave can only come through the consciousness. Consciousness that Nanak is. Nanak is not a person. Instead, he is consciousness. Nanak is one with God, the enlightened. He is illiterate in the sense that he does not have any university degrees. He is not the head of any organization. He is simple. To speak on Japji needs inner preparation. Only an enlightened one can relate Nanak. Sayam or discipline or austerities that are required is the furnace. Discipline or the austerities is the furnace. Patience or dhiraj is the goldsmith. Intellect is the anvil, and knowledge or jnana or understanding is the hammer. Fear is the bellow to fan the furnace. Tap or the austerities is the fire. Bhava or feeling is the pot in which nectar is brewed. In the treasury of truth, the coin of the word is minted. Only those who are capable of His grace are worthy of this. With the rain of His infinite bliss, reckoning reaps the fruits at the dawn of new awakening. Let me take you into the very being of these words. Sayam or discipline means giving a direction or a destination to life. Without a direction, life is like searching a black cat in a dark room. The first meaning of the word discipline is the direction or goal. As soon as you have a direction or goal, you have to gather the courage to leave all that is contradictory. You cannot attain anything in life otherwise. To attain one thing, you have to leave many things. One who wants to attain everything will end life without any achievement. To achieve or attain implies your choice. You came to listen to me. This is your choice. For this, you had to make certain efforts. You had left something that you was doing or you wanted to do. You could have used this time elsewhere in sleeping or doing something else. You could earn money. The time was valuable, but made the decision and came here. Out of many possibilities at this time, you chose to come here. Each moment, life presents infinite choices. A single moment can take you in thousands of directions. Someone may sacrifice going to the temple to reach the prostitute. He could go to the temple, but he disciplined himself and went to the prostitute. For one step, you have to reject many. Only one who does not move need no discipline or restraint. Whoever decides to move will have to take each step consciously. When there is coordination between direction, path and goal, only then discipline happens in their lives. Nanak says discipline is the furnace where gold is put for purification. In the process, the useless burns. choose your goal consciously, then your life will become the arrow. Then you will not stumble. You are not in the crowd. Now desires do not guide you. This is the difference between one who is guided by the desires and one who is disciplined. A man guided by desires runs in all directions and in the process becomes distorted. One whose life is without direction will definitely become insane one day. He wants to do 1,000 work simultaneously. While eating food, he thinks of the work. Similar, this is the situation within. Mind works and moves in myriad directions. This is the reason you are divided. Until you are one, undivided, you cannot read. Human mind is divided in many. One section seeks beauty, the other section seeks money. This goes on. You cannot rely on your mind. In that case, you will remain divided and shattered into pieces like mercury. Discipline means not to listen to your mind. Behind the mind is weakness. If you listen to weakness, then you will remember the purpose. That remembrance will become your goal. Discipline implies your readiness to relinquish all that is non-essential for that which is essential. Non-essential always attracts you, excites you, and then pulls you. You see a flower along the roadside. The flower pulls you. You stop. Take a few steps towards the flower. Still there are flowers ahead. Your journey has halted. A moment's attachment is enough to move you away from you. Truth is not infinite. Truth is solid. Falsehoods are numerous and infinite. Only one is worthy to hold and the rest is worthy of relinquishing. Door is always one to enter or exit. However, the ways to deviate are numerous. These look like the waves. As soon as you start walking, the road comes to an end and road is blocked ahead. In the same way, life is a riddle. Children's puzzles are mirror. Life's riddle is without end or any beginning. This is why a master is relevant. On your own, you cannot solve the riddle. This is what you have been doing for lives without any result. And the process of going astray continues. There is a danger in this. Quite often this going astray can become your habit. This is human nature. If you do something again and again, then you gain mastery. Because of this, one day this becomes your habit. Master implies one who has found the door, and therefore he can prevent you from going astral. You can follow the path of money, but it will lead you nowhere. You can try to save your prestige or status, and in the end you will find yourself facing the wall. What would you gain from all this? Those who are blind themselves are giving you the status. It is like a water bubble. Nanak says, discipline is the furnace. He has used the word very beautifully. Discipline is no bed of flowers. Discipline is fire. Mind always seeks bed of flowers. Discipline is fire. Mind escapes from discipline and seeks always to avoid discipline. Sorrow and involvement. Out of desire is the absence of discipline. This is the cause of sorrow. Each involvement takes you deeper into the state of suffering. And afterwards, you are more shattered. But mind never agrees to discipline. It allows the life to slip from your hand. Mind seeks happiness. But for this, it always goes in wrong directions. Try to understand this. Mind seeks happiness but finds pain and suffering in the end. It seems he finds happiness written on all doors of pain. Seeing happiness written, mind gets attracted and enters the door. Within he finds pain and suffering. All happiness leads to sorrow. Khalil Gibran has a beautiful story. At the time God was creating the world, he created the goddess of beauty and ugliness and sent both on the earth. The journey was long. Because of the dust-laden ways, their clothes got dirty. They decided to take a bath in the nearby lake. No one was around. They took off their clothes to enter the lake. The goddess of beauty went a little far in the lake. Same time the goddess of ugliness came out and changed in the garb of the goddess of beauty and disappeared. Later, when the goddess of beauty came, she found her clothes missing. The night was entering the dawn. She started hearing the steps of the people nearby. Out of compulsion, the goddess had to put on the clothes of ugliness. And since then, the beauty is in the garb of ugliness. Sometimes, like this happened between happiness and sorrow, between truth and falsehood. Discipline, pain in the beginning. Discipline always pains in the beginning, seems difficult in the beginning. In the beginning, to wake up early in the morning will appear very difficult. Your body resents, mind denies, gives many arguments to defer so that it can be postponed. Mind consoles. Early morning sleep is so refreshing and pleasing as well. Maybe it is very chilly. All the hour is refreshing. Mind is unaware of the bliss that is growing outside. That which is rising as sun outside is beyond your imagination. The bliss that is overflowing through the songs of the birds, through the blossoming of the flowers, in the morning dew and in the early morning, you remain unaware. One who misses the early morning, he will search the freshness whole day, but the mind convinces you to sleep a little longer. Such is the logic of the mind about all sleeps. To wake up from sleep is painful. To wake up is bliss. Nanak says, discipline is the furnace. When gold is put in the furnace, it gets purified. To pass through the fire, a certain preparation, willingness and strength is needed. So too, when you pass through the furnace of pain and suffering, you can attain to bliss. You also pass through suffering, however, you never accept suffering willingly. When you accept suffering consciously and accept pain and suffering, that alone becomes the path. Pain and suffering is the furnace passing through which purity and grace comes. Everyone, the worldly or non-worldly, passes through sorrow. The worldly enters this as no choice and unwillingly. He misses. One who enters sorrow consciously with total acceptance goes beyond sorrow and suffering. He makes this as a ladder. Never run away from the sorrow or suffering. Make this as your path. And one day, using sorrow and suffering, you can reach the other shore. This is like a furnace. Patience, the second word that Nanak uses is patience or dhiraj, is goldsmith. In the process of purifying gold, goldsmith puts the gold ornament in the furnace. Patience is needed for this. If you rush, you may lose. One who is not in a hurry will certainly reach. You have not known the glory of sorrow and suffering. Sorrow and suffering glorifies you. It disconnects you with the superfluous. You have not yet known the beauty and the friendliness of sorrow. One who has known its beauty is indeed disciplined. Only such a person can have patience. You can attain to God only through patience. You are seeking the most delicate, the infinite, and for that, infinite patience is needed. You sow a seed, the seasonal flowers you sow, they sprout in 2 or 3 weeks. By the 6th week, flowers blossom, and by the 12th week, the whole plant is vanished. On the other hand, there are pine trees. These live more than 100 years. There are certain pine trees in America that are even 5,000 years old. Pine tree takes time. The seed remains for many years before it sprouts. So too, there are 2 types of happiness. One you get very quickly, and that disappears that quickly as well. Remember this mathematics. If you have to seek that which is eternal, infinite patience is needed. This does not mean this will take infinite time. You can attain this very moment. For this, infinite patience is needed. One thing more, and try to understand this. If you are really patient, you can attain quickly. And if you are restless, this will take time. Haste is the sign of shallow. Be like a village farmer. He has different patience and peace. Compared to him, the city shopkeeper has less patience. Nanak's father used to pester him again and again to do something. At this, the father told him to do farming. That I do. Nanak responded. At this, the father angrily said, "Certainly you are out of your mind. When did you do farming? Where is the crop? What did you earn? I always see you sitting at home idle." That is right. This is what you see. My farming is of a different type. All that I earn is deep within me. If by God's grace you get the eyes, only then you can see. My crop and earning is not only subtle, but invisible to human eyes as well. One who is on inward journey is after the infinite crop. He has to be patient. What does patience mean? Patience does not know when. There is no word in the dictionary of patience. Only trust that one day, certainly it will happen. That is the essence of patience. That is the heartbeat of patience. Trust is the heartbeat patience. It only trusts that one day certainly it will happen. I have heard an old Hindu story which is relevant. One day during his regular wandering on the planet, Narad, who is known as the wandering mystic, has something like the status of Israel Salam according to Islamic tradition. He was wandering the earth and he met an old sannyasi, one who is involved in the rituals under the tree. Nanak inquired if he wanted to seek any answer from God as he is now going there. The old man told Narad to inquire from God how long will it take for him to attain. I have been in this austerity for last 3 lives. Narad agreed to inquire on behalf of old sannyasi. Nearby under another tree, a young man was playing his flute and singing at the same time. Just for so, Narad inquired from the young boy if he had question for God as well. He was busy in his music and paid no attention. He did not even look at Narad. And when Narad shook him, he said he has no question. Already his grace is on me. Also whatever was needed or I deserved, I already have. I am happy. Do not raise my question. On his return, Narad apologized to the old man as God said, It will take as many lives as many leaves are there in the tree. This angered the old man. He broke the mala that he was holding on the rosary, threw away the scriptures and shouted, "This is too much." Hesitatingly, Narad went to the other person and said, "In spite of your denial, I am quiet." And God said, "As many leaves are there in the tree, that much time will." Before Narad could complete, the boy took his lute in his hand and started dancing out of joy and gratitude with great fervor. And the story says, in that very dancing, the boy attained to the state of samadhi. That which was to happen in lives happened this very moment. This very moment. Intellect can serve no purposes. Man goes on using intellect as a carry-on bag. An intellect is nothing else but a carry-on bag. He fills the bag with information of all kinds. The bag contains variety of information. It has become like the garden. All your scriptures, newspapers, cures, mantras, radio, everything is stored in that bag. This is storehouse you call as memory. This is not knowledge. Knowledge is experience. But memory is not your experience. You have used your intelligence only as a bag. Nanak says, intellect is the anvil and knowledge is the hammer. Whenever a slight knowledge happens to you, its hammering will shake you to its very cells. You do not want this shock, so you go on collecting information. This information cannot shock you. The knowledge that you want to share with others has not brought any revolution in your life. In fact, you have never paid attention to your understanding. Knowledge is a shock. The real knowledge comes with experience. When you take a dive or a leap into the existence, then knowledge springs forth. Gurdjieff used to say that in the train between two compartments, there are buffers. These buffers are like shock absorbers in the car. These prevent from any shock when two compartments hit one another. So too, human knowledge works like shock absorbers. And the real knowledge shocks you even harder. Someone dies close to you. You say soul never dies. This is not your experience. Has this knowledge created any shock in your life? It has not transformed your life. You use this as a shock absorber. Those who have uttered those words have undergone through a process of experiencing. They have passed through the furnace. For them, knowledge has worked like the hammer on the anvil. This has shattered their ego. Also, because of this understanding, all relations with the body have severed. This has removed their roots from the world of finiteness. It may also happen. Someone dies at your home and the total experience of death transforms you, you attain. This incident of death acts as hammer and you are the anvil. With the shock you wake up from your slumber. No one wakes up without a shock. You want to sleep a little longer. But the moment there is a shock you wake, you have made all arrangements to save you from any kind of shock. Man searches new devices to save his ego. You think the entire world moves for you. Without you, nothing can run smoothly. I have heard about Mullah Nasruddin. One day I heard he is very sick, so I visited him. He was coughing profusely. He was a heavy smoker. In spite of serious warning, he did not quit smoking. He is my good friend, so I asked him why he does not quit if this is causing so many problems for life. Mulla replied, "Indeed, I too want to quit, but I am afraid. Last time when I quit smoking, the Second World War took place, and I am afraid if I quit smoking, the war may again begin." Such is the logic of ego. Never use your intellect as a bag. In that case, your bag will go on increasing in size and you will start diminishing. You will be lost in your bag. Your intellect glitters with the experience of life. Have you ever noticed when you go by the iron smith, you will find many broken hammers. You will be surprised to know that hammer breaks. Hammer goes on hitting and in the process gets damaged. Anvil that receives all the shocks is sealed. Instead it begins to shine. Lao Tzu says, the anvil does not break because it is passive and builds. But the hammer breaks because it is aggressive. Aggressive will break. You will not. Do you not worry about that? And only develop energy to bear all shocks. Each aggression and situation that could shatter you once will increase your endurance. Hundreds of hammers break, but the anvil remains. Nanak says, intellect is the anvil. Be not afraid. Open it and allow the hits of experience. The more your consciousness is hit, the more it will glitter. Let your life be the adventure of consciousness. Do not run away from any situation. Face it. Go through the struggle of life. Whenever your consciousness is hot, a moment of awareness arises in your life. Sometimes in the dark night, when there is light, you shake. And in that shake, there is a light of awareness. In that very moment, all darkness vanishes. For a moment, all paths become clear. Each hit of awareness of knowledge is like lightning. Because of the friction between clouds, lightning is there. So too when there is friction in life, light of awakening shines. Go through all situations in life. That will bring maturity, and out of that understanding dawns. Nanak never asked his disciples to run away from the world and its dualities. All knowledge and understanding evolved right here. You will remain childish if you run away from the wife and children. Living with children and the family, you grow into maturity. This is not an ordinary maturity. This is the maturity that evolves from deep within. Have you ever observed when a woman gives birth to a child? She does not remain an ordinary person. She becomes extraordinary. The day she gives birth to a child, she also gives birth to a mother as well. To be a mother is something qualitatively different happening. So too a man enters into a different realm. To be a father is a new beginning. Life unfolds many doors. Use all these doors, Nanak said, allow as many shocks as may be possible. Oh, be not afraid of shocks. Intellect is the anvil and knowledge is the hammer. And then what is the bellow? Fear is the bellow and austerity is the fire. You can use fear in two ways. One, you are already using. Whenever a situation of fear comes, you run away from that situation because it frightens you in life. Have you ever observed the ostrich? Seeing the enemy, it hides its head in the sand and stands. Because it hides its head in the sand, the enemy is not visible anymore. Maybe the ostrich thinks the enemy is no more. That which is not visible, how can that be? You retreat. But wherever there is fear, how can you move forward? Fear is an opportunity. What is fear? The only fear is of you disappear. If you are not ready to disappear, then how can God help you? The fear is that you may disappear or die. There is no fear other than death. One who is not ready to die, how can he be ready to dissolve in God? One who is not ready to die can never enter in love. Also, such a person cannot enter prayer. Out of fear, two possibilities evolve. One is to retreat and the other is to surrender. Accept death. Look at death with wide open eyes. Look at death with total acceptance. That very day, when you look at death with total acceptance, death will disappear. All fears in life will disappear if you look at these with wide open eyes. Nanak says, fear is the devil. The more you are afraid in the same way, the fire or the hostilities will diminish. Use fear as bellows. When the fire is getting less, the ironsmith uses the bellow to bring more air into, and with that the furnace gets intense heat. Bellow will intensify the fire. Whenever there is fear, accept the challenge and enter the situation. This gives birth to the warrior. The more you run, fear will accumulate and it will chase you. One who has learned the art of using fear. Nanak says, fear for such a person becomes the bellow, and each state of fear intensifies the fire of hostilities. There is fear in a devotee. However, he has transformed his fear in devotion. Now he is not afraid of anyone except God. Why is he afraid of God? Through fear he can create a discipline in life. Fear will save him from going astray. This is no ordinary fear. Whoever you are afraid, that person becomes your enemy. However, the fear of God is something you need. You are afraid of him, yet still you go on falling in love. Fear implies one thing. I may not miss or I may not go astray. Your fear only implies one thing. You do not deny the possibility of your going astray. And without his grace, you cannot remember him constantly. You search him, but this cannot be possible without the grace. Devotee makes fear his prayer. He does it out of fear. He makes each fear his prayer. Whenever there is prayer, he finds the opportunity of prayer. So fear is the bellow and your austerity is fire. The moment austerity is getting less or the intensity of the fire is getting less, the ironsmith uses the bellow to bring more air into it. Whenever you understand even a small act, resolutely a strange fire is born in you. This is austerity. For example, you are fasting today. This fast is not for any desire for heaven. Had attaining heaven was possible through fasting, then it was easier. Fasting is not vow or holy act either. Fasting and virtue has no relation. Fasting is a process of resolution or austerity in you. When you are fasting, the body will ask for food as per habit. At lunchtime, the body will ask for food. You will hear this. Also, you will not neglect. You will tell the belly, you will tell the body, indeed it is not the time for lunch, but I have decided to fast. You will tell the body, indeed I know it is time for lunch, but I have decided to fast for today. You will not bend your head for the sake of the body. The demand of the body is right, but today I will live with my decision. This simply implies you are lifting yourself beyond the body. Exercise. Allow the mind to seek food. There is nothing wrong in it. You remain a witness, not a companion in the process. You live by your decision in your resolution. And when you live by your decision, it is your resolution. This is the resolution. You will find tremendous energy that you have never known is arising in you. This comes through resolution. This is the device behind the fasting, not all that comes with it as a ritual. When you wake up next day, it will be a different morning. You have risen beyond body. A feeling also arises that you can go beyond mind as well. You witness that you are beyond body and mind. This is a glimpse. This is austerity. It is neither for virtue nor for anything else. Austerity is the process to know life, consciousness beyond body and mind. One who carries his life energy beyond the finite, for him the doors to the unknown opens. Nanak says, never run from anything. Seek how to utilize that. Everything has its better use as well. There is nothing in life that can not be utilized. The desire for sex becomes the brahmacharya, celibacy. Anger becomes compassion. Fear transforms into prayer. Sorrow becomes austerity. Only an actor is needed for it. Life can become a palace instead of prison. It all depends on you. You have everything deep within you. It needs a proper balance, coordination and right perspective. That inner coordination is discipline. That which is within, you have not given it any musical arrangement. Something that you consider as an obstruction becomes the way for someone else. God has created man as total, yet still has given total freedom. There is possibility of inner coordination and putting things in the right perspective. If you introspect, you will find all those whom you call criminals or virtuous. You will find one thing common in everyone. The only difference is that of coordination and arrangement. A thief enters the house. This is not easy. He has transformed his fear. He enters the house in the darkness of the night fearlessly. He does everything in such a way that there is no noise. This requires tremendous concentration and awareness. The methodology is unique, but not the direction. Zen masters say if you have to enter the house of God, then you will have learned the art from the thief. I have heard a Zen story. Once there was a unique thief. When he became old, he wanted to teach the art to his son. There is no certainty of life. He was such a clever one that he was never caught. Everyone including him knew him to be a thief, never hide himself. Even emperor honored him for his art and cleverness. Next day he took his son on the job. He cut the hole in the wall. The son remained watching. He was cutting the wall with so much concentration as if painter is making a painting. He was no ordinary. The night was cold. The sun was shivering. He used to look around now and then, but the old man was lost in his work. When the hole was ready, he took the son inside. The son was shaking out of fear. There was certain restlessness which he had never known before. He opened the lock, the cupboard, and asked his son to enter. It contained precious jewels and clothes. As the son entered, old man locked the cupboard and put the key in his pocket. As he came out of the hole, he made the noise saying, "Thief, thief, thief." The whole house woke up. The son could not understand this gesture. He thought, "This is the way. Is this the way to teach?" The maid came up to the palace where the son was hiding. He could not find the way. Fear gripped him. In such moments, intellect fails to work. He has never done before. In such moments, there is inner awakening. He was possessed by new energy. He created a sound as if mouse is biting something. The maid heard the sound. She opened the lock of the cupboard to peep inside for the mouse. The son blew out the lamp and hurriedly ran out of the hole to reach home safely. But people followed. He ran so fast that he never did before. He saw a well. So he covered the well with a nearby rock. He himself did not know what he was doing. Crowd gathered around the well, thinking that thief had jumped in the well. He rested behind the bushes and reached home. On reaching, he knocked. All the way he was thinking of fixing his father for all that he did. But he saw the father asleep. He was snoring as well. The son woke him to seek answers for all this. The father said, "You have returned safe." The angry son wanted to quarrel, but the father said, "It is too late to go and rest, and we will talk in the morning." In the morning, the son wanted to narrate the story, but the man was not interested. Still, the anxious son narrated the entire story. The father said, "You have learned the art. After all, you are my son. My blood runs through your veins. You have learned the secret. In this trade, you cannot move with intellect or knowledge. Each time you are going to thief a new place, each house is new. Old experience will not work. In a new situation, you will have to use your awareness. Zen masters say the way of meditation is like that of thief. Be separate from intellect. When fear is, awareness cannot be. The situation of danger wakes you. In the state of fear, thinking ceases." Nanak says, "Fear is the devil. Use fear to wake up. Never seek protection or security from fear. To face fear, you use security of various types. In this process, your awareness weakens. All those who seek protection are dull-witted. In a rich man, intelligence is difficult to find. Fear is a tremendous opportunity. It is a unique situation. You will shiver. Each cell of your body will shake. This is the moment to wake and allow your consciousness to remain firm, immovable." There were only 4 lines in the sutra. And look at the explanation. Tap or austerity is 5. Life is a great learning opportunity. All situations of sorrow are opportunity of austerity. Accept this situation resolutely. Accept your sickness. Never fight. And you will find after sickness, not only the body attains to health, a new consciousness is born as well. When sickness comes, consider this as an opportunity to go deep within. Otherwise, you will miss the opportunity. All such situations and opportunities can become the way to reach God. Use each situation to come closer to your destination. Bhav of feeling is the pot that brews the neck. Nanak emphasizes on feelings. Feeling implies a consciousness beyond thinking. Thought arises in the mind and feeling arises in the heart. Feeling is no logic. Feeling is an expression of love. This is not mathematical. Feeling is an expression of ecstasy. When you are overwhelmed by a certain feeling, then you are connected to the deepest core of existence. Thought is only a shadow. Thought is not only a shadow, instead it is on surface. Thought is the fence around your house. Thought is not your abode. Thought is not the inner chamber of your house. Thought creates the boundary. It protects you from your neighborhood. You are afraid of feeling. Slowly and slowly you have restricted the process of feeling. You never listen to your heart. You move with logic, move with thought, drown in the realm of feeling. What can you do to drown in feeling? You wake up each morning. With sunrise, Hindus wake up. He will pay salutations to sun. In sunlight, flowers blossom. Birds indicate the arrival of the dawn. Then the journey of life begins. This is the expression of your gratitude that fills your heart with a new energy. Before taking bath in the holy river, you will pay respect. This gesture connects you to the energy field of the river and thus to the existence. Hindus call food Brahma. Food nourishes human body. Hindus have made each situation an opportunity to remember and then come closer to the existence. To invoke a feeling deep within implies you consider the existence to be alive. Life does not end with all that you see. A feeling or how is an understanding that one soul, one being, pulsates through the entire existence. A tree may be a tree, but deep within something is growing. Something feels ecstatic within. Feeling arises deep within the tree as well. Everything in the existence pulsates with a new life. Tree, the rocks, the river, the mountains, all are sensitive and pulsates with an energy field. All around there is tremendous sensitivity. You have lost this. You have lost all feeling. This is the reason that world appears to be insipid and meaningless. All the feelings will arise in you as the feelings arise in you. Life will transform. Your entire perspective will change. Your feeling will become your pot to brew the nectar of God. If you do not have the feeling, you will remain deprived of the nectar that God is. Invoke the feeling of love within. There is a problem in this. Feeling is against thought. In your world of thought is important. Feeling is against thought. In your world that you live, thought is important. Nothing in the world can happen without thinking. And your thinking has to be aggressive. Peace and silence will not work there. There you will have to neglect the heart. Start using your heart. You will have to move slowly. Remember one thing. Move away from thinking. Bring in feeling. Sit by the side of the plant. Be with the rose flower. Do not think this is a rose flower. Name is meaningless. There is an invisible beauty. Absorb the beauty. Sit silently and meditatively with the flower. You will find a new process beginning in your heart will overwhelm your mind. Life energy can only move in one direction. As this energy overwhelms, your gestures will express. Nothing can be said of your gestures. You can sit by a flower, listen to the songs of the birds, sit resting your back by the tree, feel the ruggedness of the tree trunk, lie on the seashore with eyes closed, listen to the song of ocean, sit by a waterfall, allow the water to fall over you, feel a soft touch, feel the softness of the raindrops. Stand with closed eyes in front of the sun and allow the rays to touch your being. Go on feeling. Do not think all that is happening. Allow the waves arise in your heart. Soon you will find a new activity in your heart. It is as if something that was inept has suddenly become alive. There alone can be the rain of bliss, rain of nectar. In the tragedy of truth, the coin of the world means. For Nanak, Omkar, the existential sound, is the only word. The more truth will descend in your life, the sound will echo and you will start drowning in that realm. Only those on whom the grace descends can indeed do this. Only they can transmit the echo, the existential echo in words, through words. But Nanak never forget to remind you again and again that this cannot happen by your doing. Be not filled with arrogance. Never forget that without His grace, this work of transformation is not possible. Only those who are capable to retain the reign of bliss can transform others. Only those who are capable to retain the reign of bliss can transform others.